हेलो। Would you be able to hear me? Not yet started.
Yes, sir, I can hear you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much joining with us.
Yeah. Good evening to all of you.
Yeah, good evening, sir. We are waiting for our director and vice chairman.
Sure. Yeah, it is not correct name, I think.
Welcome, sir, Dr. Ramalesh Mukhopadhyay. Welcome, Dr. Vicky Yamamoto. Welcome, Dr. Hemant Kole. We are going to start our event. Student, please join as soon as possible. Welcome, Director sir. We are starting our events very soon. Dr. Amrish Kanwar sir, welcome.
Thank you, madam.
We will start our event very soon.
Okay.
Hello. Good evening. I'm Dr. Chandravan Senior. On behalf of DVT Fish Center at MIT Meerut, we are going to start a Ganesh Bandana for this inaugural ceremony. And after that, we will start this event.
सर्वांगी सुंदर उटिशेंदुराची कंठी झड़के माळ मुक्ता फळाची
जय देव जय मंगल मूर्ती दर्शन मात्रे मन कामना पूर्ती
रत्त खचित भरा तुझ गौरी कुमरा चंदनाची उटी कुंकुम केशरा हिरे जडित मुकुट शोभ तो बरा ऋण जुन तीनु पूरे चरणी घागरिया लंबोदर पीतांबर फणिवर बंधना सरळ सोंड वक्र तुंड त्रिनयना दासरामाचा वाटवा हे सदना संकटी पावावे निर्वाणी रक्षावे सुरवर वंदना जय देव जय देव
दर्शन मात्रे मन कामना पूर्ती जय देव जय देव
Thank you very much for the patience and you listen this Ganesh Bandana. Dr. Alija Chakravarti will further enlighten this event and will progress through the meeting.
एक बार ऑन करके करी मैडम हाँ हो गया हो गया तो करिएगा
वेलकम ऑल डिग्निटरीज वेलकम ऑल एमिनेंट स्पीकर्स एंड डेलीगेट्स I would ask our executive director, Dr. Mayank Garg, principal investigator of the DST Fish Center, MIT, to go for the welcome speech and introduce our guest of honor, Dr. Amlesh Mukhopadhyay.
Very good evening to all of you. Madam, my voice is coming?
Yes, sir.
Good evening. Very good evening to all of you. I first of all welcome our guest of honor, Dr. Amlesh Mukhopadhyay. Very good good evening to you, sir. He is advisor to R&D unit of IIT Delhi and chairman of Center of Research and Innovation. ADAMAS University Calcutta and the executive
phone ko check ghanta pore
yeah and the ex advisor and scientist G Department of Science and Technology Government of India Dr. Mukhopadhyay was also responsible for the implementation of FIST project all over India and I welcome him for this inauguration session for the a lecture series a topic which topic is health environment and laboratory safety thank you very much sir we welcome you in this lecture series and it will be a very useful for us to hear your thoughts for the implementation of FIST and we can do as you desire from us how we can implement the properly the fish center, and the a huge funding has been done by the DST for to us, and so that this the output that is desirable should come out of the project. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for joining us. I also would like to welcome our eminent speakers, Dr. Vicky Yamoto, Executive Director, Society of Brain Mapping and Therapeutic, Los Angeles, USA, Dr. Amrish Kanwar, Associate Professor from Bioscience and Bioengineering, IIT Bombay, and Dr. Hemant Kole, Deputy Director, ICMR Calcutta, for sharing their research to our participants. I welcome all of you, sir, and in this series of lecture, we would be having 3 days series. One is on 19th December, second on 16th January, and then on 30th February. And we would be having around 9 eminent speakers from different parts of India and abroad. And after out of 9, there are 4 dignitary speakers from internationally placed, mostly from USA. And this type of lecture series will help our scientists and students to know about how the laboratory practices are, what the health issues are, and how the environment problems can be solved in this era of, and it will be very useful for us. I also would want to thank our chairman, Shri Vishnu Sharan, and our vice chairman, Shri Puneet Agarwal, and Dean of Academics, Dr. D.K. Sharma, for their continuous support for this FIS Center and the motivation they used to give our faculty members and the students to participate in different research projects. I also want to thank the organizing committee and scientists of DST FIS Center, Professor Alija Chakravarti, head of the DST FIS Center, and the organized secretary of the this event. She is the architect of this event, and Dr. Nitin Sharma, Dean of Student Affairs and the head of the Biotech Department. Along with him, Dr. Chandbhan is also associated with the organizing team. I want to thank all the organizing committee members for their efforts they have done to get this event started. I also want to thank Vishwas Gautam, Dharmin Sharma, and our students, student Udit Narayan Sharma, Ishiti Gupta, for their unconditional support to make this event possible. I welcome all the participants. There are around 70 participants who will listen to this grand event. And I welcome all of you to hear this lecture series. Thank you all of you. Thank you, Alija ma'am, over to you. Dr. Alija Chakravarti, over to you, ma'am.
Yes. I would like to our guest of honor, Dr. Amlesh Mukhopadhyay, give us some enlightenment regarding DST FIST. He has extensive extensive experience, 30 years experience dealing with, on behalf of Government of India, implement this FIST system. So, Dr. Amlesh Mukhopadhyay.
Thank you, Professor Alija Chakravarti and Professor Mayank Garg of Meerut Institute of Engineering and Technology, and other dignitaries and the speakers set out for this today's evening lecture series. It is indeed a pleasure for me to come back to a center which I had started some kind of associating when I was with the DST
and approached DST by the institute to provide some support to augment the research activities of the institute, especially for the biotechnology activity. And then we advised them to take the advantage of the program, which is named or titled as FIST. I think this was a year 2017 or 18. I don't remember exactly the correct year when I was approached or DST was approached for some kind of support. And based on our advice to the institute, the people came forward very enthusiastically and they made a proposal for the scheme. Now, the scheme is very open, transparent, and competitive. So based on the strength of the institute, which I could anticipate, the institute stood in the competition and received some amount of support. I, in fact, do not remember today how much support the Government of India through this program had provided to this institute, especially for the Center for Biotechnology or Department of Biotechnology. But today, when I see that the institute has utilized this money and set up the center for augmenting the research in the biotechnology activity, I am very, very satisfied that yes, there are people who can be motivated, who can be supported, even the small amount, and utilize that small amount in a very, very effective manner for the betterment of the science, betterment of the research at the institute level, and the betterment of the society, what the science they do. I'm really very, very satisfied today. And towards that, I think the center or the institute together has developed the series of lecture over a spread of 3 days in next 3 months, I believe, December, January, and February. And not only the 3 days over 3 months, they could able to attract good speaker. That's another very, very encouraging of this institute, as well as the Government of India's support to the center, that at the end of the day, the ultimate beneficiaries are the students of the institute, who receives the some kind of scientific input through the lecture process, where I'm very sure that this eminent speaker from IIT Bombay, NICED Kolkata, and the Los Angeles, what is that institute? Brain Mapping Institute of USA, which are set for today, will be beneficial for their lecture. Now, definitely the congratulations should go to the institute, should go to the people, professors who are associated with this center and pursued to set up the biotechnology center with the support from Government of India. Congratulations to all of you, to the management of the MIET, and the people who are associated to make this support in a success mode. Now, coming to the seminars part, this is very apt selecting a topic like health, environment, and laboratory safety. In fact, everybody talks about health, environment, but very rarely we could see a topic on safety for the laboratory, where research scholars and faculty members are working almost 10 to 12 hours in a day. In fact, there are many incidents happened because of the lack of safety, and slowly the lab safety norms, lab safety cultures are coming in, especially for the chemical laboratory, especially for the biological laboratory and some of the engineering laboratory. We all aware about the incidents at various places. The accidents happened at the laboratory, and we need to safeguard, we need to create a safety environment and the culture of safety at the laboratory where students and faculty members are spending their valuable time of the day and their career. So I'm sure that the speakers which are slotted for today and the next 2 days will definitely discuss about other these aspects along with many other aspects of the environment and the health issues, and it will definitely create a good takeaway for the students when they go through the lecture. Thank you and congratulations once again to the institute, to the people associated, and especially to Professor Chakraborty to organize this event. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable lecture. We are privileged to have you in this platform. Thank you so much. Our next speaker, first technical session speaker, Vicky Yamamoto. Dr. Vicky Yamamoto is a cancer scientist at Keck School of Medicine, University of Southern California. Prior to join USC, Dr. Vicky has worked for Mount Mary University Scripps Institute and Cedars-Sinai and Caltech, California Institute of Technology. She has published major journals including Cell, Developmental Cell, Cell Reporter, PLOS, Journal of Alzheimer's Diseases, Neuroimage, and Oral Oncology, and has written several book chapters. Dr. Yamamoto's current research expertise are in developmental neurobiology, cell signal transduction, cancer stem cell, molecular targeted therapy, screening and identification of small molecules of cancer treatment, establishment of tissue bank and clinical trials. She has published paper with collaboration with Nobel laureate David Baltimore when during our stay in California Institute of Technology. She hopes to bring a wealth of knowledge and expertise in the field of biomedical sciences to the advisory board and hopes to achieve the goal of helping clinicians determine the most effective and precise treatment for cancer patients. And Dr. Yamamoto is one of the founding members of Society for Brain Mapping and Therapeutics, which was established in 2003. She has been serving as a member of board of directors of SBMT and the Brain Mapping Foundation since 2007. She has served on many committees, including publication committees, as a member of the editorial board, co-chair at the industry committee of SBMT, where she provided LIASO with near 3,000 industry partners of the society. She is currently serving as an executive director for SBMT since 2017. Dr. Yamamoto holds other leadership role in a number of organizations, currently serving as the chair of the board of directors, Hand in Hand Community Health Clinic, and a chair of the scientific advisory board of Blue Horizon International. Dr. Yamamoto received undergraduate degree BS in biological science and BA in chemistry from Mount St. Mary University and doctorate degree from Keck School of Medicine of University of Southern California, Los Angeles. So I would like to invite Dr. Vicky for her presentation. Over to you, Vicky.
Hello. Hi. Hi, Dr. Chakraborty. Hi. Thank you very much for your kind invitation and a kind introduction. I have known Dr. Chakraborty for more than over 10 years. When I was a PhD student, she was a professor at the USC. Oh, my goodness. It's been a long time we have known each other. So thank you very much for your kind invitation. So let me open my talk here. Can you see the screen right now?
Yes, yes, okay. We can.
Great. So again, thank you very much for all the organizing committee and also Dr. Chakraborty for kindly inviting me to the session. And I'm very honored and excited to be here. So today I'm going to talk about advancement in cancer therapeutics. Again, I'm actually from a University of Southern California in Los Angeles. So just wanted to show that I have no financial conflict of interest to disclose for my presentation. So briefly here, this is the university that I work in Los Angeles, which is the USC Keck School of Medicine. This is such a fantastic, diverse community. And I hope that some of you, especially the students, to have opportunity to meet here at the USC if you have opportunity. Okay, so for today's talk, the outline is that I'm going to talk about the cancer in general, what is the limitations and problem and some of those unmet needs in cancer treatment. And I'm going to also talk about a little bit about the advancement in the current cancer research pertaining to my research as well as some of my collaborators in my research, and as well as the importance of a multidisciplinary and global collaboration to fight this cancer. So first of all, cancer is a worldwide problem. So as you can see from this panel, you can see that the worldwide cancer cases is expected to increase by 37% from 2012 to 2025. And worldwide cancer deaths is expected to increase by nearly 39% from 2012 to 2025. So WHO also estimate that there were about 9.6 million of cancer-related deaths in 2018, and this figure is expected to increase in the next 20 to 30 years. So here, this is actually the top 10 list of the global cancer incidence by location. So global wide, it is known that cancer, number one cancer type in the world is so far lung cancer, followed by the breast, colorectal, prostate, and the stomach. So I know that I'm actually presenting here mainly for people living in India. So I was a little bit interested in what is happening in terms of cancer and incidence in India. So this is the annual incidence rate of all cancer in the states of India. Turns out that incidence rate is actually increasing since back in 1990s to here up to 2016. The incident rate by location is maybe slightly different from the world worldwide. Basically, the recent studies back in 2016 also shows that the number one new case of cancer happening in India is actually breast cancer, followed by head and neck cancer, that's including lip and oral cavity, and then followed by cervix and uterine, and then the lung and stomach cancer and so forth. However, number-wise, because of a number of population in India, it seems like a very high, but then if you take a look at age adjusted and case per 100,000 people, now actually India is has a low, much lower case number compared to other countries such as Australia and the United States and Norway and the UK and so forth. So the incident rate is per 100,000 people are still lower than most of the countries, but then still compared to about past 20 years or so, the case is actually slightly increasing every year. So this is actually the case of many in the United States. So if you take a look at the case, or I would say any progress in cancer treatment since back in 1950s, do we see any big improvement? The answer is unfortunately no. So if you take a look at the left panel, the deaths per 100,000 people in the United States back in 1950 is pretty high. But then if you take a look at 2004, the death rate actually declined dramatically. And so the same for cerebral vascular diseases, as well as infectious disease such as influenza and pneumonia. But then when it comes to cancer, unfortunately, the deaths per 100,000 people are slightly improved, but then not as much as we wish to see, unfortunately. However, not all the cancer surviving rate is actually increased. Some of those are increased, some of them are actually has not been changed much. So if you take a look at the five-year survival, some cancer type, especially when it comes to breast cancer, prostate cancer, and blood-related cancer such as leukemia and lymphoma, you can see that the five-year relative survival rates are actually improving dramatically compared to the 1960s and 1970s, which is very encouraging. However, many cancer types, especially the solid tumor, we are actually still lag behind in improving a five-year survival. Especially when you take a look at the pancreas cancer, for instance, five-year survival is only 5%. So it means that when you're diagnosed with the pancreas cancer, after 5 years, only about 5% of people are still alive. And the lung cancer, liver cancer, brain, stomach, and ovary cancer, those are relatively popular cancer, but then still we are not able to increase the survival rate. So those are the area that we still need to improve. And so the factors that why we are struggling to increase the survival of those cancer. So major points are because of treatment resistance. So somehow only about 25 to 30% of patients respond well to chemotherapy in many cancer types, especially in the solid tumor. And another major factor is that because of the recurrence. So many types of cancer will actually eventually come back after the treatment, especially for the first few years. And also another factor is metastasis. So metastasis is the process by which a cancer spreads to the other part of the body. This is actually the major cause of mortality for the cancer. And of course, there are some other factor that causes for us to treat really difficult for oncologists and surgeons is that many of those patients actually come to clinic too little too late. And of course, some cancer type will be difficult to reach by surgery. So this also caused the patient to die also early as well. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the head and neck cancer because that's actually where I study and that's the department I come from. So head and neck cancer is a cancer arise anywhere in a part of the head and the neck region. That's including nasal cavity and oral cavity, tongue to salivary gland to vocal voice box around the larynx as well as the throat area. So in head and neck cancer, normally this is actually caused by the series, stepwise series of mutation, and most notably caused by tobacco smoking. So normally, yes, of course, you know, we always have some sort of a genetic mutation can happen through smoking, sometimes having a bad quality of air to bad quality of you know, water, for instance. And yes, of course, you know, genetic mutation can happen from time to time. But then normally our body is equipped with a great preventive mechanism, such as DNA repair mechanism. So if you have just only one type of mutation, usually it's not cause any cancer because again, our cell defensive mechanism and DNA repair mechanism will repair all these injury. But then when you smoke for heavy smoker, smoke for a long time, what's gonna happen is that we are going to have a series of a couple of a different type of mutation will happen. So when that happens, then our natural repair mechanism will not work and eventually the cancer will arise. So especially for head and neck cancer, especially the tongue cancer to oral cancer, usually it starts from a very, very small hyperplasia or some small, what do you call it, small patches in the presence of like white or red patches. And usually it does not actually cause any pain. And if that won't go away for 2 to 4 weeks, please try to see a doctor because it may be an early sign of a cancer. So how to reduce the risk of getting a head and neck cancer? So foremost, you know, don't smoke tobacco because the head and neck cancer and also any other type of cancer such as a lung cancer to bladder cancer, those are actually caused by smoking. So if you are already a smoker, then please try to stop smoking. If you are not a smoker, then please don't stop smoking. Okay. So that's the number one cause of cancer. And the next thing is that heavy drinking, notably more than 10 to 20 drinks per week, also raise the also possibility of getting a head and neck cancer. And also having a chewing tobacco or consuming a chew betel nuts also is a major cause of head and neck cancer as well. And then, so for, especially for, notably for younger generation, HPV, which is a human papilloma virus, also known to cause a head and neck cancer, especially for a young generation. But then a good thing is that now we have a very good vaccination to prevent the HPV infection. It's Gardasil 4, and then now currently the Gardasil 9 has been approved to for as a HPV vaccination. And well, normally this vaccination is probably promoted for women to prevent the cervical cancer, which is notably caused by HPV. But then now, especially in the United States and in the Western European countries, they are now highly encouraged for boys or young guy, man to also receive this vaccination, because this may have a potential to prevent HPV-related head and neck cancer. In fact, in the United States, FDA actually approved for both women and men from age 9 years old to 45 years old. Especially, I don't know, familiar with this vaccine situation in India, but if your institute or your clinic actually approve the HPV vaccination, then we really encourage you to receive this vaccination. And also another way to reduce this risk of getting a head and neck cancer is to visit your dentist regularly, and then ask a dentist to carefully look for any sign of lumps, abnormal lumps or bumps or any red or white patches in the mouth, especially something that doesn't have any pain. So, and also the current, the current cancer treatment. So there's a lot of problem facing, especially in case of utilizing chemotherapy, because traditional chemotherapy that we have right now is targeting any type of cells which are rapidly dividing. So of course, cancer is a type of a cell which are rapidly dividing. So this is a must be a great target. However, some other cell types, such as a hair follicle to gut lining, the lining of our intestine, for instance, and also reproductive organs. Those are the type of also cells which are also rapidly dividing. So most of those traditional chemotherapy will attack not only cancer, but then also many of those normal tissues as well. So this causes a serious side effect. So the most effective treatment that we as a cancer scientist need to develop will be to try to minimize the serious side effect by developing those drugs or agent that target only cancer. And another promising medication or the agent that we need to develop is metastasis, because metastasis is by far the number one cause of death in the cancer patients. So, in order to effectively develop a better treatment, is we need to study cancer really carefully and what will be actually the effective targetable markers or signaling system. So for us, especially in our lab, we are looking into cancer stem cell. So I'm pretty sure that most of you will know what is stem cell is all about. So the stem cell is actually this very important source in our tissue, which has a capability to develop and differentiate into specialized cells and specialized tissues. So we, of course, you know, in our brain, we do have a stem cell. In our skin, we do have a skin stem cells and so forth, which is very important in maintaining our healthy tissues. But then recent years, we find out that unfortunately, cancer also has a stem cell-like or stem cell population. So we are thinking that those cancer stem cell or cancer initiating cells is actually responsible for tumor initiation, to relapse, to metastasis, or even chemotherapy and radiation therapy resistance. So so for us, we are interested in trying to target something that kill specifically on cancer stem cell, and hopefully that will improve to kill the cancer. So by utilizing those screening core facility here at the USC, we actually managed to screen thousands of different types of small molecule inhibitors, some of which are actually still under development or the new type of drugs, as well as already FDA-approved drugs with our collaborators. And then we successfully managed to identify several drugs or small molecule inhibitors which can potentially use to target cancer stem cell. So what you're looking in the bottom of the panel is actually the head and neck cancer in the form of a cancer stem cell. So cancer stem cells normally grow as a sphere form like this. So when it comes to testing our new drug, which are potentially killing cancer stem cell, we normally have to grow cells in a sphere form like this. So, and if you take a look at the middle panel, this is actually the, after the treatment with this particular medication with a small amount of 10 nanomolar. And as you can see, at the 20 nanomolar, in a dose-dependent manner, you can tell that the size and the number of those cancer stem cell spheres are decreasing. So, and then normally after we identify some of those drugs, we always have to test on a mouse model. So one of those drugs that we actually identified, we actually try to inject those cancer human head and neck cancer cells in the left flank or the flanks of a mouse, and then we combine with the irradiation, which is actually the common mode of treatment for head and neck cancer. So as you can see, if this drug can effectively eliminate cancer stem cell, if you take a look at the purple column, which is actually a combination of this the drug and the radiation therapy, you can clearly tell compared to control or drug X alone, or even just the radiation therapy alone, you can tell that the size of the tumor volume will be successfully reduced or maintain the size. So, which means that this drug successfully suppressed the tumor growth. So another possible solution for fighting off the cancer effectively is to try to prevent the metastasis. So as I discussed with you earlier, that the number one cause of why those cancer patients die is because of metastasis. So for our lab in the past, we identified there's this unique protein called alpha-catechulin, which is associated with the rho-guanine nucleotide exchange factor, which is basically a protein which is important for cell-to-cell attachment. So we found that from using a human actually samples, in that this alpha-catechulin in a normal gingiva or normal cells, you don't see much expression, but if you take a look at the patient sample, especially grade 2 to grade 3, as the grade of cancer progress, you start to see those alpha-catechin expression more and more. And then this protein's expression is particularly highly expressed in a tumor front, which is actively invading surrounding normal tissue. So we thought that maybe this is actually the factor that is progressing metastasis. So utilizing the mouse model, we also prove that by eliminating this alpha-catechin protein expression from the head and neck cell line, we will successfully show that eliminating this alpha-catechin protein will prevent the metastasis from injection of the oral or neck region to the lung region. So we are really excited that hopefully we are going to be able to find some of those small molecules or some sort of a drug that can potentially eliminate the expression of this alpha-catechin, and then hopefully we are able to develop this drug to stop the metastasis. So as for your information, at this moment, especially in the United States, we do not have any approved drug to prevent the metastasis. So hopefully with this finding, we are able to find some sort of an agent or drug that can prevent the metastasis. And we hope that this medication will improve the 5-year survival or overall outcome of a cancer treatment. So another thing that we just start to work with another collaborator is to, this is more like for clinical research, is to use what we call boron neutron capture therapy, or BNCT. So this is a really not really a new concept. The concept wise, it was exists since 1930s, but it's just that this technology has not been utilized, especially in the United States. This treatment is actually approved and then already in a clinical trial in Japan, and as well as in Helsinki in Finland. But in the United States, so far, BNCT treatment has not been utilized in cancer. But basically the principle is that in this treatment, we normally introduce this drug or carrier that has a boron isotope, 10 boron. And then this boron bound drug are very unique in a way that they preferentially uptake by only cancer cell, but then not the normal cell. So what's gonna happen is that after the boron uptake, we irradiate with a very low energy neutrons. And then this neutron irradiation will then make the boron to break down and then generate the radiation. But then this radiation is very short. So what happened is that they're going to injure only themselves, meaning the cancer cell, but then not to the surrounding normal tissue. So this will cause the tumor cells to lyse, destroyed, but then the normal surrounding tissue will not be affected. So this is going to be a very, very good targeted therapy. And then luckily, we are able to collaborate with another university close to USC, which is at the Loma Linda University. And we also found, identify a nuclear reactor source. So remember that we have to use low energy neutrons. So neutrons normally require huge nuclear reactor. So this is actually one of the major problems that why this technology has not been utilized by most of the country, because it requires a huge major facility to house the nuclear reactor. But then nowadays, there are a couple of companies who has accelerator-based neutron source, which is pretty small, as you can see from the picture. It just occupy only one space that is kind of equivalent to the space that housed by MRI machine. So we hope that this technology will be utilized in head and neck cancer soon. And then lastly, another solution is that we better have some sort of a technology to diagnose cancer early. So we are actually on the process of collaborating with another investigator, Dr. Bahram Jalali at the UCLA, by utilizing this unique technology called phase stretch transform. So basically this is what we call photonics. This is basically a study of a light generation, detection, manipulation through emission, transmission, modulation, signal and processing, application and sensing. So here the major goal is to try to develop the way to detect cancer early, as well as to try to visualize cancer better during a surgery to remove the cancer more efficiently. So for instance, example, so PST or this technology is basically is utilizing the algorithm that works by performing some sort of mathematical operation that identifies objects' edges. So for instance, if you take a look at the picture in the bottom, so when someone is trying to use the standard telescope to try to visualize a star, so if you try to use like a regular traditional telescope, you will be able to see only large stars but then you are not able to visualize those distant small stars. But then if you apply those phase stretch transform algorithm, then you are able to also see, clearly visualize those small stars. So how we can use in medicine or biology? There are a lot of promising application. For instance, in this lab, they are trying to also track the small microvasculature in a retina. So if you take a look at the image on the left side, this is just a regular camera to visualize those back image of the retina to see the vasculature. But if you apply again with this special phase stretch transform algorithm, then you are able to visualize very small, tiny vasculature that you cannot even able to see from a traditional standard imaging system. So by using this technology, their lab and then we try to utilize this for different type of cancer detection. And then my understanding is that their lab is already start to utilize this method to try to detect the breast cancer. So what happened is that especially for a woman with Asian descent, somehow our breast tissue is turns out to be very look like a very very murky, very cloudy appearance that normally sometimes miss the cancer, a small tiny cancer by mammography. But then utilizing this PSD, somehow according to their preliminary result, they are able to see through and detect a small cancer despite some of those female has a very dense breast tissue, which is actually very common in among Asian population. So we are really hopefully that we can actually utilize this PST in also detecting head and neck cancer. And that's what we are actually collaborating with this investigator at the UCLA. So another next few minutes, I would just like to show you some of those, the organization that I'm actually involved in. So I'm actually, so as Dr. Chakraborty introduced me, I'm actually currently serving as an executive director for the Society for Brain Mapping and Therapeutics, or SBMT, which is our mission is to try to improve the diagnosis, treatment, and rehabilitation of a patient afflicted with a neurological disorders. So, so basically our organization really push, you know, encourage everyone to try to collaborate with the multidisciplinary field. Someone, for instance, for me, I'm actually working for cancer, but then I also work with some of those collaborators from the engineers to radiology to chemists to physicists. So this type of collaboration really will result in many different types of effective treatment. And in fact, that in my past research with the NASA or JPL, which is a branch of NASA, we were able to find a better way to detect a brain tumor using infrared thermal imaging. And that actually resulted in a publication in the past. And then in addition to those normal activity for our organization, for the past 8 years or so, we also started to have a collaboration or collaborative partner, and then not only within the United States, but then also in Europe and Asian countries as well. So we actually initiated this movement through G20 or Global 20. And we actually named this as a Neuroscience 20 or N20 summit. So every year for the past 6 years or so, we actually partner with the G20 nations and also with the local government to foster more collaborative relationship to try to tackle various different type of neurological diseases, so that we can come up with a more innovative, effective, and affordable cancer treatment, which will result in a reduction of medical cost. So the next G20 or N20 summit will be held in Rome in October 2021. But then I noticed that G20 will be happening in India in 2022. So I'm really looking forward to visit India in 2022. And hopefully I'll be able to actually visit maybe your institute, and then try to see if we can have a maybe productive partnership with your institute in the future. So with that, I end my talk, and thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much for your nice talk, very informative. And it's covered our India also. So we all are really privileged to have speaker like you. And I'm sorry that you had to wake up so early in LA time. It is early morning. And the session now open for a few questions. You can ask if anybody having any question for Dr. Vicky, please text.
There is a question from Stuti Gupta, and she would like to ask, does fibroadenoma in breast increase the chances of breast cancer in the future?
Okay. Can you speak that again? It's a fibroadenoma. Yes. Chance of breast cancer. So yes. I'm not, specialized in the breast cancer, but then indeed, fibroadenoma. This is probably if that happens in a cancer, this is probably may have a chance to progress into more aggressive type of cancer. So definitely, if you see fibroadenoma, you will need to keep monitoring for a future occurrence of those breast more aggressive type of cancer. So indeed, you have to take a closely monitor.
Thank you very much. Is there any question from other participants for Dr. Vicky? You can write in the chat if you are not able to get connected with your mic.
I don't think I can hear. Can you? Okay. So I see some question from a chat box. So let's see. I see the question says, my question is, how much combined therapy effective? So combination therapy is somehow, in some case it is effective, but in most cases, unfortunately, combination therapy is not effective. So for instance, in head and neck cancer, for instance, normally one type of treatment is not really effective, such as radiation therapy alone or cisplatin or platinum-based therapy. So that's why we combine it. So if you combine those two different types of modalities, it will increase the overall outcome in some case, but not 100%, unfortunately. So that's why a lot of oncologists are now trying to see what type of a combination, let's say, for instance, cisplatin-based or radiation therapy combined with the immunotherapy. So some type of combination is work more than another, but then not all of a combination therapy is effective. So That's the job of an oncologist to find out. And then in order to see the effectiveness, it is also important to see what type of mutation is present in cancer patient. Some drug is more effective in certain type of a mutation. So if you have a cancer, it is before you receive especially for chemotherapy or targeted therapy, it's very important to check if what type of a DNA mutation is present. So that's something that we need to keep in mind. And then next question, how HPV can infect oral? I think that presumably, which means that how HPV can cause a cancer. Okay, so what happened is that HPV is a very, very common type of a DNA virus. So in our lifetime, probably 90 to 95% of us will get HPV some way or another. But the HPV virus has so many different type of subtype, like HPV 15, 18, 16, 23, there's just so many different types. And then only few of them are known to cause cancer, especially what we call HPV 16 and HPV type 18 are known to cause cancer. So if you get this type of a HPV, then what happens is that those type of HPV 16 or subtype 18 are preferentially infect the oral lining of the throat. And then most cases, it will go naturally, you will cure, no problem. But then in some individuals, some small percentage of people who get this HPV, this HPV virus will live chronically in the throat. So that will induce a cancer. So we don't know a lot about HPV infection, not yet. But then we are finding out more and more that somehow that really depending on the host. Some of us cannot shake off this infection. So in that case, then this may cause cancer. So move on to, I don't think I can. Okay, it's kind of breaking up. So if possible, could you please type it? Okay, so okay, quickly, I'm gonna go over. Eliza, do we have a time? Are you okay?
Yeah, we do have time. Yeah,
you go ahead. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so the third question that I'm getting is, ma'am, can we say cancer is curable now? Okay, the answer is cure normally means 100%, you know, healed. So in the cancer research or in a case of a oncologist, we usually don't say cure. Normally, yes, we can say that cancer, if the cancer is not coming back within 5 years, then we say cure. But then we don't normally say cure. So unfortunately, because it's really hard to see where the cancer is hidden. Sometimes like only few cells will still stay behind. Sometimes as a form of a cancer stem cell-like, and then sometimes it pops up again. So that's why we normally in cancer research, we don't easily say cure, but then yes, for conventional use, yes, we sometimes say cure if the cancer did not come back for 5 years after the treatment. And the next question is, how can the possibility increase to reduce lung cancer in world? Okay, so important thing, again, as I mentioned in the lecture, lung cancer, the number one cause normally is smoking. So the most effective way to reduce the cancer risk in lung cancer would be to stop smoking if you're a smoker, and then don't smoke if you're not a smoker yet. And also air pollution sometimes can cause a cancer. So another thing is that important thing is to try to try to reduce the pollution or live in a cleaner, you know, area.
Thank you so much, Vicky, Dr. Vicky.
Thank you.
And I really, really obliged. And now our next speaker is Dr. Amresh Kunmar from IIT Bombay. Over the Chandravansa.
I welcome Dr. Amresh Kunmar in this inaugural lecture series. And thank you very much for accepting our invitation to present your research to our audience. Dr. Amresh Kunmar is an associate professor in the Department of Biosciences and Bioengineering at IIT Bombay. He received his PhD from Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur in year 2006. Dr. Kunmar was a postdoctoral research scientist at the Department of Neurobiology, Physiology and Behavior, University of California, Davis, from 2008 to 2011, and at the Department of Developmental and Biology, University of California, Irvine, from 2006 to 2008. His research area of research are biophysics and computational biology. He is a recipient of Innovative Young Biotechnologist Award for the year 2012 from DVT India, a Young Faculty Award from IIT Bombay, and the Excellence in Research Fellowship from IIT Gandhinagar. He has 48 publications under his credit that includes a recent publication in Nature Scientific Report on differential binding affinity of tau repeat region R2 with neural specific beta tubulin isotypes. He is a member of Biophysical Society and the American Society for Cell Biology, USA. I welcome Dr. Amresh Kunmar in this lecture series. Over to you, Dr. Kunmar.
Can you see my screen?
Yeah, of course, they are on.
All right. So thank you very much to the organizers at MIT, and it's my pleasure to give a webinar for this college. I have a long history of association with your college because many of your faculty members have visited IIT Bombay for various QIP courses which I've been organizing, and one of my PhD students also came from your college. In that sense, I have a long history of association. By training, I'm a physicist who mostly works in the area of biophysics and computational biology, but today I'm going to talk about something different, which I started during the COVID time. And one of the reasons I could do a number of different types of things because of the various training programs which I keep organizing. What you see here on the screen is some of the training programs that I have organized in past in the domain of laboratory safety and ergonomic safety for faculty members of various engineering colleges. And you can, if you look at this picture carefully, you will identify many of your college teachers in these photographs. Okay. So every year, some of your colleagues do come to IIT Bombay to attend these QIP courses. I'm really happy about it that we get opportunity to discuss and share the knowledge that we have. All right. So what I will do, I will first talk about some general biosafety, and then I will try to talk about some of the work which we did at IIT Bombay, started at IIT Bombay during the COVID time, by taking a divergence from my original track of research. Okay. So what is biosafety? Biosafety refers to the protection from many infectious biological agents that can make us sick. And there are various kinds of biological agents that can make us sick. It could be a bacteria, virus, it can be a fungi, it can be protozoa, there can be multicellular parasites, and many other things that can make us sick. And this is typically the length scale of various types of things that can infect us. If you look at the size of the bacteria, bacteria are generally smaller than the our mammalian cells. And if you look at the size of the viruses, viruses are much more smaller than the bacteria. Most of the viruses, I must say. So this is the kind of scale we are talking about. Now, pandemics are not something which are very new to this world. Okay? Pandemics have been happening in this world for a long time. And if you look at the history of the pandemics, it starts from very, very early in the history of mankind. And some of those about which we have heard is Black Death, there is smallpox, many of the recent ones were yellow fever, then Spanish flu, Russian flu, HIV is also considered like a pandemic. And if you look about the most recent ones, they were SARS, then swine flu, MERS, Ebola was something which happened in the African countries. And if you look at the figure of death that has happened because of all of these, in the MERS, the figure of death worldwide was about 6.4K. But today, if you look at the total number of deaths that has happened because of this, it stands at 1.65 million, okay, as of today, as per the WHO. Now, if you compare the current pandemic, then if you look at the case fatality rate, and how infective it is, if you look at the, and that is something which can be measured using something called basic reproduction number. So if you look at the basic reproduction number of this COVID-19, it is slightly higher than the seasonal flu, okay? Lower than the SARS, but if you look at the case fatality rate, its case fatality rate is much more lower than the Ebola, which happened in African countries, okay? But it has really become a very big problem for us just because of some of the factors which I will describe later. But you know, there is a so this slide lists some of these viruses which have infected us in recent past, okay? And the current SARS-CoV-2 is a earlier neighbor of SARS-CoV-1. And there is a very common notion that all the viruses come from bats. It's not true. Actually, not all the viruses come from bats. Okay, they come from different types of organisms. For example, HIV came from non-human primates, H1N1 came from swine, okay? Nipah virus came from pigs, okay? Hendra virus came from fruit bats, and so on. So it's not like that all the viruses come from bats only. Now, if you look at how different kinds of biological agent can infect you, there are various routes of exposure to a infectious agent that one can have. One can get infected by the infectious aerosol, and which is currently the predominant mechanism of infection due to COVID-19. Then the other route of infections are contact of these biological agents with skin, eyes, or mucus of the membrane. Then if you accidentally get inoculated by contaminated SARS, let's say in a laboratory, that can give you an infection. Then animal bites can give you infection. Ingestion of various kinds of infectious agent through mouth pipetting or contaminated hand can give you infection. Now, since the infection, the COVID-19 infection is mostly spreading, and people believe that it's mostly spreading through the aerosols. If you look at the aerosols, scientists are mostly interested to understand, I mean, how much we can infect others when we cough and sneeze. So for example, when you're coughing, you are actually releasing close to 2 billion viruses. You are actually releasing close to 3,000 droplets, and these droplets travel at a speed of 50 miles per hour. Okay, when you sneeze, you are again spreading somewhere around 1 to 2 billion viruses, 20,000 droplets, and they travel at 200 miles per hour, much more than a cough. If you are breathing, it gets out with a very low velocity. But again, the number of droplets you are releasing could be anywhere between 50 to 5,000. When you are speaking, it is lower. The number of droplets released are lower, and they again travel at low velocity, but still you can get infected, and one can calculate the average number of viral particles that are being emitted per minute from these figures. Now, let's say if somebody has coughed or sneezed, then there are various ways in which one can get infected. For example, if the person is just standing in front of the other person, then due to the ballistic trajectory taken by these aerosols, one can get infected. Or these droplets can travel via air, and then they can infect another individual who is without mask at a distance. Or it's possible that these aerosols also land on some surface, and then you accidentally touch those surfaces, and then they infect you when you touch your mucous membrane or eyes or something like that. Now, why COVID-19 is different from earlier outbreaks? One of the reasons is that COVID-19 is much more contagious than influenza due to asymptomatic condition. And the asymptomatic condition in COVID-19 refers to the people who are infected by virus but do not show any symptoms. And this is why sometimes very hard to control that who is infected, who is not infected, and how do you isolate. And the other factor which is contributing to this is that this virus is much more stable outside the human body than the other viruses which have infected us in past. Okay, and then this COVID-19 virus has mutations that make them efficient in binding to the host cell. Now, if you want to avoid COVID-19 infection, there is a very successful formula for the infection, that longer you get exposed to the virus, you get infected. So if there is higher concentration of virus and you get infected and you are basically taking that dose for a longer time, you are going to get the infection. And therefore, if you want to successfully dodge the virus, you have to treat and greet everyone from a distance. You have to invest in a good mask, avoid talking to the people too much, especially without mask, and wash your hands with soap and water. Okay, so these are some general instructions which you have been hearing from many other people from various other sources. All right, and if you want to see some of the movies on viruses, one of the Hollywood movies is this Contagion, and one of the movies which is based on this Nipah virus outbreak in South India is this virus movie. It's a very nice movie, you can watch it. Now, when we talk about the disinfection or sterilization or sanitization, a general person is always confused. I mean, for a common person, all of these words might mean the same thing, okay? But actually, cleaning, sanitization, disinfection, and sterilization mean different things they have different meanings. For example, when you're saying that I'm going to clean something, that means you are going to just remove the dirt from the outer surface. You're not going to kill any bacteria and virus. When you talk about sanitization, what we are doing, we are using some chemical agents, okay, or some other method to reduce the concentration of bacteria and virus which can infect us to a safe level. Normally, this is 3 to 4 log reduction. Then when you are saying disinfection, for disinfection, you are using more higher industrial grade chemicals and you kill more bacteria and viruses. But when we talk about the sterilization means you are completely wiping off any form of life on the object. Okay, so you are getting rid of bacteria and viruses completely, and that is something which is required for mostly surgical procedures. Okay, so as long as we are in disinfection and sanitization regime, we are good enough, and this is good enough to avoid the infection. Now, there are different types of methods which are used for sterilization. One of the common one is a dry heat sterilization, which is often used in the laboratory. Then steam sterilization, which is generally done in the laboratories. People use autoclaves, and you can also do it, which is like a pressure cooker. Then there are chemical sterilization methods. Okay, one can use alcohol, bleach, sodium hypochloride, and many other things. Filtration can also filter many microscopic forms of life. Then there are various gas sterilization methods, for example, using ozone, hydrogen peroxide vapors, and others, and they are mostly used in industries. And there are now many new products which are coming for consumer use also. Then sterilization via ionizing radiation. for example, gamma radiation, X-ray radiation is another technique for sterilization, but it is slightly costly. And the one of the sterilization method which is low cost and could be very effective is sterilization via non-ionizing radiation, in particular the UV radiation or ultraviolet radiation. Right. So what I'm going to do today, I'm going to talk about the UV radiation and what is the technology which exists today and how it has been, it can be used to develop different kinds of consumer products. So if you look at the spectrum of the light, what you see that this UV spectrum extends from 315 nanometer to 280 nanometer. From 100 nanometer to 300 to about 400 nanometer, and this is further divided into three regions: UVA, UVB, and UVC. And this is mostly the UVC region, which is very effective in killing the different types of bacteria and virus. And in particular, 254 nanometer wavelength is optimum for killing all kinds of bacteria and viruses. So it's not like that the entire UVC spectrum is very effective. If you are around 254, that's where the most of the killing happens. Okay. And then towards the end of the talk, I will also talk about another developing technology, which is also in the UVC regime, but it is called far UVC, and I will talk about it after a few slides. Now, how does UV radiation kills the bacteria and viruses? So the mechanism of UV inactivation of the microorganism is to damage the genetic material of the bacteria or virus. Okay. So what it does that the UV damages the DNA and RNA of the microorganism, which often results from the dimerization of the pyrimidine molecules. Okay, so what it does, it causes dimerization, and due to this, the replication cycle of the microorganisms gets blocked and it cannot replicate further, and that's how they die. Now, when we talk about the UV radiation, in order to kill any microorganism, you require a certain amount of UV dose, and the amount of UV dose which is required to kill a microorganism is different depending on the type of microorganism. For example, bacteria are easy to kill, viruses are slightly harder to kill, then fungus could be even more harder to kill, and each of these microorganisms require different amount of UV dose. So it's not like that there is one common UV dose which will kill all kinds of bacteria and viruses. And the amount of UV dose which is received by any microorganisms depends on the irradiance of the source at a particular distance, and then for how much time you are exposing the microorganism. So irradiance is something which is measured in watt per meter square. For example, there are different types of UV lamps. So UV lamps also come in different kinds of wattage. For example, they start from, let's say, 9 watt, they go all the way up to 256 watt, depending on the kind of tube you are using. For example, this is the irradiance of a 36 watt lamp. And you can see that as you are going away from the lamp, the irradiance decreases. And normally this has a 1 upon R square dependence. So as you move away from the light source or the UV light source, your irradiance decreases. And therefore, the amount of UV dose that the surface will receive will also decrease as you move away from the source. Okay. So the amount of UV dose received by a surface depends on the irradiance of the source at that distance, particular distance, multiplied by for how much time you are exposing the surface. And whenever you are measuring the killing of the bacteria or virus, normally it is measured in terms of the log inactivation. For example, when I say that one log inactivation, it means you have done 90% of the killing and only 10% of the original population is surviving. When we talk about two log inactivation, that means 99% killing. When we talk about three log inactivation, that means 99.9% killing. When we talk about four log inactivation, it means 99.99% killing, and so on. Okay. So for most of the consumer products which are available in the market, people do the validations up to three or four log inactivation. Okay. Now, this slide shows the UV dose which is required for killing different types of bacteria and viruses. And what you can see from this slide that UV radiation, in particular the UVC radiation, can kill all kinds of bacteria and viruses. And here the UV doses are listed for some of those, some of the bacterias. Okay. And you can see that the amount of dose varies for different types of bacteria. Similarly, if you look at the spores, spores require slightly higher dose on average. Okay. Then here is the dose for the yeast. Here is the dose for different types of viruses and dose for protozoa, algae, and so on. So different microorganisms require different amount of UV dose. And what you should take as a message that this UV dose is different for different microorganisms. And this is something which depends on the irradiance of the lamp and the exposure time. Okay. Now, UVC technology is not something which is a very new technology. UVC technology is something which is being used for more than 50, 60 years. Okay. At a very large scale as well as at small scales. For example, it is used in domestic water purification. So most of the RO units which you see in your homes have a UV lamp. Then they are used for ultra pure water. They are used for wastewater treatment. They are used for processing of the water, industrial drinking water, fish ponds, aquaria, swimming pool, agriculture recycling. Then if you talk about the air disinfection, they are also used in the air ducts of the HVAC system, okay, to disinfect the air as well as to stop the growth of the mold, fungus, and other things. So what you see here is that many UV lamps are mounted right next to the filter to stop the growth of the mold, fungus, and other things. And similarly, they are also used for the surface disinfection for food processing, packaging. All right. So it's not like that UVC technology is something new and this is being used now in the time of pandemic, but it is something which is a very well-established and well-proved technology. So at the beginning of the pandemic at IIT Bombay, we also started to work on to develop some of the low-cost UVC-based escalation solutions. And one of the reasons we wanted to come up with some of the UVC-based escalation solutions was that you cannot use the existing liquid-based methods for all kinds of surfaces. For example, you cannot use soap solutions, alcohol-based sanitizers, bleach solutions, and steam due to presence of various types of dead-gate materials, electronics, or time or error involved in manual disinfection. And at that time, we also knew that the germicidal effect of UVC light is very well known. And it was proven by that time that it was good enough to kill many different types of emerging viruses, for example, SARS-CoV-1, then CCHFV and Nipah virus. So there was already some research, limited amount of research, where people had shown that using the UVC radiation, one can kill different types of bacteria and viruses, in particular, many of the emerging viruses, for example, SARS-CoV-1 and Nipah virus. So having this knowledge in mind, we also started to work towards developing different types of UVC escalation solution. I'm going to show some of the solutions that we have developed during the time of pandemic. We have licensed some of these technologies to the industry, and we are also doing some of the consultancy projects for some of the industry. And these are some of the reports which came in the press. For example, you could see this report from Press Information Bureau on 19th of April that IIT Bombay inspires Southern Naval Command to build low-cost UV disinfection unit. In fact, at IIT Bombay, we came up with the news of developing the UVC-based installation solution on 31st of March. Okay, and this was something which was published in the newspapers, which was heavily picked up by the media, and then many other people, many other institutes, many companies followed the same direction. So we are really very proud of what we did in the beginning of the pandemic. So what we first did, since everything was locked, what we did, what you see here, is actually we used whatever was available in the laboratory very easily. We used those to make those installation solutions. And the idea was that, you know, we have to design something which is very simple but effective. So what you see here that we have this small stainless steel kind of box. Actually, it was a trash can which we used to develop our first prototype of portable UV installation unit. This was a cylinder of box of size 25 centimeter by 36 centimeter. Length was 36 centimeter, diameter was 25 centimeter. And we made these units using a simple UV lamp, which was used in the water purifiers. And then then we also conducted some pathogen experiments, and using those pathogen inactivation experiments, we were able to prove that these design units can provide you more than 4 log inactivation of MS2 phage. Okay, if you expose them to UV exposure inside this unit for 90 seconds. So in 90 seconds, it gives you a pathogen inactivation of something which is more than 4 log. And at that time, we also knew that this MS2 phage is a virus or a bacteriophage which infects bacteria, E. coli. Okay, so we developed this prototype and we also tested the efficacy of this prototype, and then it we went to the public, and this was something which was picked up by the various newspapers across the country. Okay, and this product which we developed in the beginning is available for non-exclusive licensing, and we have also given a non-exclusive license to one company so far. Then what we did, we also developed a slightly bigger germicidal UV cabinet. And again, what we did, since we were not having all the equipments, all the work software set, so we actually used a cardboard box and then some of the racks from one of the hot air oven. And we developed this portable germicidal UV cabinet. And we gave this germicidal UV cabinet to our doctors in the hospital to disinfect their mask and many other things. Remember that in the beginning of the pandemic, there was a huge shortage of mask and many other things. So they started to use all of these things. So this box had a dimension of 45 centimeter by 45 centimeter by 35 centimeter, the inner dimension, and it could accommodate large objects. And again, we did experiments, and what we showed that by using the MS2 phage, that if you expose the MS2 phage for more than 3 minutes inside this unit, it gives you more than 7 log inactivation, which is a very, very high inactivation. So this was something which was used by the IIT hospital for a very long time. This is also available for non-exclusive licensing, and we also gave non-exclusive license to one company. Then the third one which we met after developing those two units was something which was to disinfect a very large area. And I must say that all of these projects were done with one of the virologists at IIT Bombay, Professor Kiran Kondabagil. So he's a virologist by training. And prototyping designing was mostly done by me and Professor Kumarishan. And all the validation experiments were conducted by Professor Kiran Kondabagil. Then the third one which we developed, what we did, we took a laboratory stool, we removed the seat, and we mounted 4 tube lights. Okay, and then we came up with this simple prototype of a wheeled sterilization unit, which could be used to disinfect a large area, for example, a room. So you put a number of objects in the room, and then you turn on this light, and you can disinfect a large area. Of course, this is something which has to be used without presence of human beings. Okay. And again, this was picked up by the media. So what I will do, I will just play a small video which shows the functioning of these units before I go forward.
We have developed a portable UV sterilization unit.
Can you hear the sound? Do you hear the sound?
Yes.
Okay, perfect.
We have developed a portable UV sterilization unit, a germicidal UV cabinet, and a wheeled sterilization unit. Portable UV sterilization unit and germicidal UV cabinet can be used for sterilizing small objects, whereas the wheeled sterilization unit is intended to sterilize a large area. We have given our germicidal UV cabinet and the wheeled sterilization unit to our IIT hospital for sterilizing various kinds of objects which they use daily.
So now we have also developed a robotic version of it, and we'll be also making it available for licensing very soon. Now, after that, we also came up with a prototype for sterilizing the entire car, and this was something which could be also used by ambulances. Okay, and again, we did the experiment, and we showed that using those experiments that in about 35 minutes, you can achieve a 9 log activation of all the illuminated area using this prototype. And this was something which could be operated using a 12 volt battery, and you can also, you could also potentially use it with your car charger. All right, then one of my colleague, Professor Sanjeev Srivastava, was working with the COVID samples. So they were bringing many multiple COVID samples from the government hospitals for doing the proteomic testing. And this is something which we made, which we call a safe biohazard transporter. This was something which we developed to bring the COVID samples from the hospitals to avoid any infection due to spillage or touching of the samples.
You need to open the sleeve like this and you keep it aside. So this is the main container which has a form basement in which the box will be kept, and it will be covered with this. So you have a container box, and this has a levels like this. Have you can see this level, like you can fill your ice or the boxes or the solvents in this level only. So first of all, what you will do, you will take out this box. You will put the lid safely. Now, you have to switch this red switch on this way. Only you just press this red switch here. So after that, you can see from here, there is a blue light which is glowing. You can easily see this. So this is off and this is on. So once you are done, you switch it off. The box is sterilized. Now put your samples containing box inside. You have kept your sample collection box inside. This box is now checked. You switch it on.
All right, so I will stop here. Then currently, as I said, that we have been working on developing a robotic UVC-based sterilization device, and this is almost ready. This project is funded by Vadhavan Research Center at Bioengineering at IIT Bombay. This UVC technology is conventional UVC technology is quite cheap but very effective. Now there is a new technology which is coming up, and this is called something which is far UVC technology. So far UVC radiation is something which is emitted by the Alzheimer's lamp. This is the short form of something called excited dimers lamp. And it has been shown that this far UVC could kill pathogens without damaging the mammalian skin. And far UVC light is very unlikely to be a human health hazard, as it penetrates through only the outer dead cell layer of the human skin and tear layer in the eyes. So it is completely safe for human skin and eyes. And therefore, it can be used in the presence of human beings, whereas the conventional UV cannot be used in the presence of human beings. And it has been also shown that this far UVC light, which is 207 to 222 nanometer, it efficiently inhibits bacteria without any harm to exposed mammalian skin. And it has been now shown, although I don't have it in the slide, that it can inactivate H1N virus and some of the human coronaviruses. So people have used the BSL-2 strain of some of the human coronaviruses, and they have now shown that this far UVC radiation can also inactivate the BSL-2 strain of human coronavirus. And the long-term effect of this far UVC lamp has been also studied on the mice. And this says that if you provide a chronic dose or a longer exposure to the far UVC radiation, it does not cause any DNA damage in the mice. So this new technology is quite promising, and we have recently received, we are about to receive funding from BIRAC, which is called Biotechnology Industry Research Assistance Council, to develop different types of solutions for inactivating pathogens in a tunnel. So we have basically received funding to make tunnels as well as conveyor belt kind of systems to inactivate various types of bacteria and viruses using these far UVC lamps. And this is something which is which will be carried out in partnership with another company, which is Litex. Okay. So these are some of the things on which we have been working on. And as I said that we have been also doing biosafety training for a very long time. So this is something which we did for all the employees of Bank of Baroda under the flagship of Bank of Baroda IIT Bombay Innovation Center, which we have at IIT Bombay. And we did a webinar for all the Bank of Baroda employees on how to be safe during COVID-19 time. And this was something which we did again in the early phases of the pandemic because a lot of bank employees were getting infected by the COVID-19. Okay, so we have at IIT Bombay, we have expertise related to UVC sterilization in terms of designing of UVC products, calculation of UVC doses via modeling, measurement of UVC radiance, and then inactivation studies using different types of reproductive pathogens, which can be bacteria, virus, or spores. And we are now again looking for more industry partners for development of for UVC based products. We are also doing some consultancy projects for different types of UVC sterilization products and ozone-based sterilization solutions for industry. So with this, I will thank you for your attention. And this arrangement for the QIP coursage, which we are doing in January. So one of the QIP course we are doing from 18 January to 23rd January. This is called Biology for Engineers, which has been already attended by many of your colleagues. And this time this will be online. The other one is other course, which has been again attended by some of your colleagues, Laboratory and Agronomy Safety for Engineers. This will be again conducted this time in online mode. And this will be from 25th of January to 30th January. So if you're interested, you can register for these courses because applications are now open. Okay, so thank you very much. And I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Now session is open for question. Any question?
So there is one question, I think. Sir, could you please tell me how much harmful UVC is in comparison to UVB and UVC if UVC will get exposure on human skin? Okay, so UVC is quite dangerous. Okay, it can burn your skin. Okay, and it can also cause the DNA damage. So this is absolutely bad. Now, if you have to look at the which one will be having more energy, then you have to go back to this slide. Okay, so on this slide, what you see is the wavelength of different kinds of UV radiation. Okay, so if the wavelength is increasing in this direction, okay, then the energy has to increase in this direction. Okay, so you are getting more and more energy if you are going in this direction. So that means if you are going from UVC to UVB or UVA, it is having less energy. Okay, so in that case, it will cause less damage, I would say. Any other question?
Thank you so much, Amrit sir. Thank you for your appropriate presentation, because due to pandemic, we need this kind of information. And thank you so much for your valuable time and presentation. Really, really, we highly appreciate and we are privileged to have you in this platform.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Now, our speaker going to be Dr. Hemant Kole, Scientist, Deputy Director, National Institute of Cholera and Enteric Diseases. Over to Nitin, sir.
Thank you, madam. Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes.
Welcome, Dr. Hemant Kole. As a panelist of this web series, let me introduce, this is my privilege to introduce Dr. Hemant Kole. Dr. Kole is the scientist E and the deputy director of Division of Bacteriology, ICMR, National Institute of Cholera and Enteric Disease, Kolkata. After completion of his master degree in physiology from University College of Science and Technology, Calcutta, he joined in National Institute of Cholera and Enteric Disease, Calcutta, for his PhD degree under the super guidance of Dr. G. Balakrishnan Nair. He joined as an associate professor in Department of Physiology, College of Medical Science, Nepal, where he devoted entire heartly in the teaching medical students till 2000. In the meantime, Dr. Kohli got opportunity for postdoctorate research under Dr. Deepak Sarkar at Department of Physiology, the State University of New Jersey, USA. After completion of 1 year in university, Dr. Kohli moved to the Boston and joined in VA Healthcare Harvard Medical School as research associate and worked there on molecular mechanism of Barrett's esophagus and to work on endocarcinoma under the leadership of Professor R.K. Goyal. So till date, Dr. Kohli has filed the seven patent in his credential and 82 publications as well. So in real sense, Dr. Kohli is the true researcher, and we are very fortunate that today we are going to interact with the Dr. Kohli, and we will be fortunate that Dr. Kohli will share their experience during which he got during their postdoctorate fellowship and the various institute professionals. So thank you, Dr. Kohli, and welcome once again in this session. Dr. Kohli, over to you.
Oh, thank you very much. Is he hearable to you, Dr. Sharma? You can hear me?
You're audible.
Yeah. Thank you very much. So nice introduction about me. Yeah, really. And thank you very much to Dr. Chakraborty so giving me opportunity over here. So the I'm going to talk about the, actually I'm working in the Diderot disease. Actually it is the ICMR Institute. So in the ICMR Institute, there are 25 institutes throughout the India. So among them, see, the ideal research actually we do over here. So among them, actually the I'm actually nowadays involved with the development of vaccines in different organisms, especially the Shigella now. So you understand maybe that the with the heading, development of next generation OMB based Shigella vaccines by the way of multi dimensional approach. Yes, it is actually the a long story. I try to tell you the in short, but in this project actually we have the six PhD done, and they are working in the four students are working in USA, so in different bacteriology laboratories. And the I'm trying to tell you that the this way the choice of the vaccines assays. So when you go for the any experiment or any project, so you have a you have the milestone. That is the that way I'm actually arranged in my the lecture. The choice of vaccine assays, how to go for that, then multi-dimensional immunogen approach and next generation OMB based vaccine, how developed in this. So you know very well the enteric pathogen of global importance of the organisms are mainly actually cholera, maybe ETEC also there, and typhoidal fever also, but the Shigella is really, really problem in our country. 800,000 death, 5 to 10 years children every year. So the, maybe for the students, so need to explain about the Shigellosis, what is that? Shigellosis is actually bloody diarrhea, also known as bacillitis dysentery. Why it is? because the organism is bacillus in shape. And Marlow syndrome, the Marlow, Dr. Marlow described, that's why we also say that the Marlow syndrome is a foodborne illness caused by the infection. This is actually not throughout the India. It is this actually West Bengal, Bangladesh, in this area is so much. Shigellosis actually rarely happen in the animal. But other than, so but you can manipulate in and surgically or as well as the physiologically by the animal shigellosis. Shigella actually discovered 100 years ago, but still we don't have the vaccine. So the this isolation characterization we have done here in ID hospital, infectious disease hospital. So we have seen the really notable in the Shigella isolation in ID hospital. And the why I go for that, because the multi-drug resistance, we don't have choice of drug, only the ceftazidime only the choice of drug, but most of these the organism most of the drugs are drug resistant. And so the summarize all those the problem, so prevention only possible with the vaccine. Why? The sanitation developing country like India is really this problem. Rehydration therapy is not possible. Rehydration also you can go for with the diarrheal disease with the ORS or any other solution. But due to the invasion or bloody diarrhea, it is not possible to use the ORS. It will not help. So antibiotics only diagnose, it is the multi-drug resistance, and vaccine only the solution, but still 50 years people are trying. So we do have the lots of vaccine in phase one trial, but not to the phase two or any market. So the before the going for that, so I developed the model, but you have to assay. Without assay, you cannot say the immunogen may be good. We do have the good immunogen, but we don't know this immunogen is good or not. But for that, you need the assay system. That assay system I developed in first animal model in efficacy study as well as the immunogenicity study. What is that? The physiological manipulation and surgical manipulation and immunological manipulation by the process, I did the 3-4 animal model for the Shigella. Then we have seen the host specificity of the bacteria. The Shigella, as a host specific bacteria is the guinea pig, is a host specific. And when go for that, the organ specific, we have seen the Shigella is now the organ is the large intestine. It is colonized over here. And that way I develop the step by step by immunogenicity as well as the efficacy study through this model. And we develop the model, the surgical manipulations of the guinea pig for the Shigella. And then I tested in different immunogen. So, and also we published this actually a small model and host specific higher than the rabbit, no pretreatment required. Shigellosis like human colonization ability is very high. Protective efficacy is really nice. So this and this model I use throughout my Shigella vaccines development. The guinea pig, the pathogenic and efficacy study Shigella. So we have seen here The Mice-Lung model also there, but it is not an intestinal model. Rabbit luminal model is there, not an ideal model. And the guinea pig any test model, it is not an intestinal model. So that way we have started the work. But this is actually, so I was the student of the NICET when I PhD student, I started that work, this with the help of our teacher, Dr. Deepak Sen and Dr. R.K. Kumar. First, we developed the oral live conjugate Shigella vaccine. How? So one plasmid from the Salmonella, and I introduced to a Shigella, and then Shigella become virulent. And that the conjugate transconjugate the Shigella vaccine I use and published several papers and proved that this is the immunogenic as well as and got the some predictive efficacy in different model. But I was not happy with the transconjugate strain, because that transconjugate strain only protect the homologous strain, not the other, because the Shigella have 50 subtypes, serotypes. So we have to cover all, so that I like to get the universal vaccine. That vaccine will cover all the organisms, but it is not possible with the transconjugate the live organism. And also transconjugate organism is not a good good for the actually reactogenic. And then we started with the collaboration of Dr. Jiro Mitobe with the National Institute of Cholera, National Institute of Infectious Disease, Tokyo. He developed one live attenuated vaccine, but the reactogenicity is less. How they did? So when the RNA binding protein expressed into the type 3 secretion system, and then it become virulent, as well as the reactogenic is also less. But this actually sometimes this vaccine giving the reactogenic and defer some time and giving the more more immunogenic, but not sometimes it's not predictive efficacy high. So I was not happy with that the both to the live attenuated vaccine. So then I tried the collaboration with Dr. Munoz Chakraborty and started work with the heat kill vaccine. So that heat kill vaccine give the homologous protection, not the heterologous also. So the heat kill vaccine only use the Shigella flexionary 2A. So we have other the Shigella Sony, Shigella Boydi, Shigella dysentery, but those are not giving to the protection. And then my professor, Dr. G.V. Nair, we developed the combination vaccines idea. That is the we have seen the limitation of the single serotype, heat kill, Shigella immunogen, is only the protection to the homologous. And then we developed the six serotypes needed to get broad spectrum homologous as well as heterologous protection. What is that? So we know the Shigella 50 serogroups, there is a A, B, C, D, among them, Shigella type 1, the epidemic strain, Shigella flexionary 2A, 3A, and 6 are share the common 11 common antigens. So these are the predominant in endemic area. And then we have seen the Shigella boidi predominant in endemic area, and also we took this Sony as because the predominant in developed country. So we took the six strain for next immunogen preparation, and then with the collaboration of Dr. Professor Takeda, Japan, and then we select these strain for immunogen preparation, and then we check these strain are highly genotypic and phenotypic characters, and we selected among 200 strain, only 6 strain we selected from there, and then my student Dr. Surit Maiti, and he developed the heat kill immunogen in different combination manner, and then he published in different journal, and then we have seen here the Shigella dysentery type 1, the protective efficacy is not so much so much because of the after heat kill. Actually, somehow the antigen is destroying. But we have seen the OMPA, the main immunogenic protein, and then we started the next formulation of ketosan alginate coated OMPA subunit vaccine, and this subunit vaccine give us more or less better the immunogenic because why? So the alginate actually protect the stomach acidity, whereas the ketosan actually adhere to the endocyte and stimulate the secretory IgA. But we have not seen the protective efficacy in mice model. So this time also we have not got that type of protection. So we are not happy. When we check the protective efficacy, but when you challenge with the different wild type of strain is not giving protective efficacy. So then we started work. When we were working with, we saw that the Shigella bubbling some antigen that is known as the OMV. The most of the gram negative bacteria actually secrete the outer membrane vesicles that actually known as the the next generation immunogen, and this as because the OMV originate generally from the plasma membrane of the cell, it reflects the outer membrane composition and containing LPS and glycoproteins. And the OMP proteins are well encoded to the participant in the component. As a result, so giving the good immunogenicity and protective efficacy. So next, this preparation also very, very easy. So the overnight culture or the 8 to 10 years grown of bacteria, the supernatant. So you can use the culture soup, and then ultra centrifugation. Then you can get the outer membrane vesicles, and then we immunize the female mice, and 0, 7, 14, and 21st day. They after immunization, and then we challenge to the pups. How? So we immunize the female mice, and then the mate with the male female, and then we got the pups 21 days after immunization, and then we challenge to the pups because the So actually, the shigella is to the children disease. So we checked into the pups, and then we have seen the different IgG, IgM, IgG, and reciprocal immunogenicity titer. We have seen very nicely, and the protective efficacy. We have seen the 80% more than 80% protection than the heat kill or live attenuated organism, and this protection actually received through the secretory IgA, because neonatal gut mainly contain the milk from the mother, and then the immunoglobulin is the gut of the as the anticoagulation effect on the immune pups. So we have published in famous microbiology, and so we have, and then the vaccine research, and then trial in vaccinology in different. And so when we're going for that, the OMB preparation is really, really is the cost effective. So due to the low yield production of Shigella OMB, to solve the problem, so we focused on high yield, how to do that. So Tolpel system, the gram-negative bacteria is required for outer membrane stability. So we block the Tolpel system A, and after the blocking, the Tol A, so the secretion of the organism is increased, and we have seen also the production of OMB are significantly higher than the higher in Tol A deleted mutant, and then we compare with the protein, and also LPS is really higher than the wild type, and then we have published the patent in, we got the PCT, and then we published in the development of cost-effective vaccine candidate with the outer membrane vesicles, Tol A disrupted Shigella boidi type 4. And so we are not stopped still now, but to reduce the reactogenicity, so we are working on not only the six organisms. So nowadays we are using the tetravalent, means the four organism, to combat the 50 serotype. And so now we come into the conclusion with my work. So the choice of vaccine assays, so we use, so the guinea pig model is the best model for the assay of Shigella immunogenicity as well as the predictive efficacy. So the multidimensional immunogens we approach, so we see the multi-serotype OMB based antigen is the best, and next generation, if I say Tol A deleted OMB is the best antigen, is the next generation OMB antigen. So this actually formulation, serotypes of next generation OMB immunogen, 29th March 2017, NICED and MSD Hillman Laboratory developed a MOU with the Hillman Laboratory for the development of and commercialization of the vaccines for the shigellosis and other diarrheal disease. And then recently, this is in really very good shape. The MSD Wellcome Trust Hillman Laboratory will be manufacturing the low cost product, phase one and phase two proof of concept will be in the Africa 2020, but it has not started due to the COVID-19. So the we have a timeline for that. The this maybe it will come to the 2022 in the market. So we have the contribution of the lots of students as well as my teacher. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kole, for your valuable experience sharing with us. And India, like a underdeveloped country or developing country, whatever we can think, and it is killing rate is too much, and in a in infant to children. So at least we have some vaccine coming up. That's a good news. And thank you so much for your lecture and sharing platform with us and giving valuable time to us. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, all delegates and dignitaries. Thank you, all speaker, Amrit sir, Dr. Vicky. So have a good night. Okay. Over to Chandravan, sir. Any questions? Session is open for a question. So no question. It was so nice and elaborate description. So with your permission, I want to conclude today's session. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Hey, thank you very much. Looking forward to the next meeting.
Okay.
January. Okay. Bye.
Bye. Thank you, Amrish sir.